Greetings, everyone. Welcome. My name is Lee Rayford. I'm professor of African American and African Diaspora Studies and co-director with Professor Tiana S. Bichelle of the Black Studies Collaboratory here at UC Berkeley. The collaboratory is a recipient of a Mellon Foundation's Just Futures grant, a collaborative initiative to address racial inequality through bold and unique humanities-based research projects. Today's event on Black Violent Rebellion and Black Futures with Kellie Carter Jackson and Lenora Warren, curated by Abolition Democracy dissertation writing fellow Michael J. Myers II, is the last, yes, the last of our larger spring event series organized by the Abolition Democracy Fellows Program of the Black Studies Collaboratory. And if you've attended any of the events in our series in person or via Zoom, you have experienced, I think, what Christina Sharp, one of our guests in this series, calls wake work, the practice of putting and keeping breath in the Black body. You can find out more about our spring series, including recordings of almost all of our events at our website, blackstudiescollab.berkeley.edu. I am joining you today from my home in South Berkeley, which is near the campus of UC Berkeley, also sited on the territory of the Huchun, the ancestral and unceded land of the Chechenyo-speaking Ohlone, the successors of the historic and sovereign Verona Band of Alameda County. We recognize that every member of the Berkeley community has and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land since the institution's founding in 1868. One way to make concrete such an acknowledgement, one way the BSC is making concrete such an acknowledgement, is through the payment of Shumi land tax, a material way for non-Indigenous people living in the East Bay to participate in the rematriation of land to Indigenous people. Before we turn it over to Michael J. Myers II, curator and moderator of today's event, we want to thank all of those who have made today possible and the semester as a whole. BSC Project Manager Extraordinaire, Barbara Montano, BSC Graduate Student Assistant, Gilberto Rosa Duran, all of our graduate student assistants and undergraduate research assistants, the Department of African American Studies, helmed brilliantly by Chair Professor Nikki Jones, with incredible staff support from Sandy Richmond and Maria Heredia, Elena and ETS for running today's webinar and their excellent tech support throughout our series. Our Spanish language interpreters for today, Elena Velez and Isidra Mencos, live captioning from Aberdeen. We want to thank the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. We want to thank today's panelists, Kellie Carter Jackson and Lenora Warren. We thank you for making the time to join us, and we hope that it will be in person next time. We want to thank the ancestors. And we want to thank all of you for joining us in the webinar. Today's event is being recorded and will be publicly available on our website. Finally, we want to thank the curator and moderator of today's event. Michael J. Myers II is from Buffalo, New York. He's a PhD candidate in the Department of African American Studies here at UC Berkeley. Michael's dissertation is a multifaceted and multi-layered experimental storytelling project in Black studies. Thinking with the writings of Sylvia Winter, Michael examines the ways in which violent Black rebellion intervenes in the form of a question mark to challenge our current epistemological, socio-political, juridical order, and simultaneously and concomitantly to postulate different possibilities and potentialities of being. I am grateful that we conclude this series with Michael's event. Over the course of this year in the BSC, and over the course of his time here at UC Berkeley, we've borne witness to Michael's flowering as a truly original thinker, asking the deepest and most difficult questions with a fierceness that is remarkably generous and also incredibly tender. We have benefited, Michael, from your care and from your commitment to community. And I am really thrilled that you are leading today's discussion. And I hand it over to you.
Thank you. So I want to begin first by introducing Dr. Carter Jackson and Dr. Warren. Kellie Carter Jackson is an associate professor in the Department of Africana Studies at Wesley College. She's the author of the award-winning book, Force and Freedom, Black Abolitionists and the Politics of Violence, which won the James H. Broussard Best First Book Prize, was a finalist for the Frederick Douglass Book Prize, a finalist for the Museum of African American History Stone Book Prize, and listed among 13 books to read on African American history by the Washington Post. Kara Jackson is also co-editor of Reconsidering Roots, Race, Politics, and Memory. Her essays have been featured in the New York Times, Washington Post, The Atlantic, The Guardian, The Los Angeles Times, NPR, and other outlets. She's also been interviewed for expertise on MSNBC, PBS, Vox, Monet, the BBC, Al Jazeera, Slate, and a host of other documentaries. Kara Jackson is a historian in residence for the Museum of African American History in Boston. And lastly, she loves a good podcast. She's the co-host of the podcast, This Day in Esoteric Political History, and the host of Oprah-demics, the study of Queen Talk. And you can follow her at K. Kara Jackson. And Lenora Warren. Lenora Warren is a scholar of early American and early African-American literature with a focus on literatures of abolition, insurrection, and the politics of resistance. Warren received her BA at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and her PhD at New York University. Her book, Fire and Water, Sailors, Slaves, and Insurrection in Early American Literature, 1798 to 1886, was published with Bucknell University Press in 2019. Fire in the Water tells a new story about the troubled history of abolition and slave violence by examining representations of shipboard mutiny and insurrection in late 18th and early 19th century Anglo-American and American literature. Fire in the Water centers on five Black sailors whose experiences of slavery and insurrection either inspired or found resonance with fiction. Equiano, DeMarvesi, Sinkay, Madison, Washington, and Washington Good. These stories of sailors, both real and fictional, reveal how the history of mutiny and insurrection is both shaped by and resistant to the prevailing abolitionist rhetoric surrounding the efficacy of armed rebellion as a response to slavery. Her work has also appeared in Atlantic Studies, XVII, I don't know Roman numeral, sorry, and New Perspectives on the 18th Century Literary Imagination and Red X Report. Warren is currently working on a book on the legacy of Phyllis Wheatley and works of Black women writers in the 19th century and 20th century, and the relationship between art making, joy, and resistance. All right, thank you for having me. Thank you for being here. I have a prepared statement that I would like to read ever so quickly. First, I want to thank Rayford. As always, I'm incredibly grateful to you and Tiana for allowing me to be a part of the inaugural cohort of the Black Studies Collaboratory. I thank everyone in the BSC for the laughter we shared, even when the jokes were at my expense, for the drinks that always came at the right time, and for the ways in which everyone involved through the work has contributed to stretching my own scholarly thinking. The BSC has been among the best things of which I have been a part in graduate school. And the brave, courageous, generous, and fostering of a hella Black community amongst a very diverse group of people within the collaboratory will always serve as a beacon of hope for imagining the possibilities inside and outside the academy. And I also want to thank everyone on the Six in our department. After all these years, the Six continues to be a home away from home. And I know this is only possible because of the generosity, the thoughtfulness, the care, toil, and labor that went into creating the conditions for this possibility to exist. Shouts to all the old homies from the Six, Sharice, Bush, Jarvis, Catherine, Kim, Kenley, Essence, Yana, Marco, Amani, Kia, Zachary, and Mahasan too. And shouts to everybody in the new Six. I'm grateful and appreciative for my advisors, Dr. Taylor, Dr. Jones, Dr. Cohn, Dr. Prostein. Shouts to Dr. Janelle Scott, and shout out to Dr. Esmer for transforming the ways in which I read and think. And shouts to my first teacher, moms, pops, I love y'all. Shouts to Buffalo, shouts to my friends, both old and new. And in the spirit of last week's presentation by Crudix, I'm forever grateful of each and every one of you. And I love you all. I thank everyone that has made this event possible. And that's from top to bottom, and even the rebellions that occurred during the summer of 2020 that made this funding possible. I thank Dr. Kellie Carter-Jackson and Dr. Lenora Warren for so graciously accepting my invitation to come talk with us. Just yesterday, my friend and colleague, AG, said I should just come out and say it, and so I will. I'm a bit nervous because I want you both to like me, and I want to be lifelong thought partners, all right? I hope this doesn't make it weird. in the service of providing everyone in attendance with an arc of today's proceedings, I will begin by briefly explaining why I was so excited to be in conversation with Dr. Carter-Jackson and Dr. Warren. I'll then work towards commencing the dialogue by asking each to briefly provide an arc of their book for those in attendance who may not yet have had the opportunity to read their work. And then I have three lists of questions. The first list is comprised of the questions that I will primarily be pulling from throughout the conversation. This is mostly scaffolding, such that we can get to the ideas that are contained within the projects. The second list contains some more of the difficult questions that I really want to ask, but I'm going to wait to see if the opportunity presents itself to do so. And the third list is composed of two questions, one for Dr. Carter-Jackson and one for Dr. Warren. Now, these questions, though contextually relevant, in the interest of full disclosure, are ultimately related to my niche ideas within my own work. But my goal here is to simply have a conversation and we can just see where it goes. And I understand that there will be a Q&A towards the end as well. Excuse me. All right. So both published in 2019, Carter-Jackson's short title book, Force of Freedom, and Warren's short title book, Fire in the Water, are at the cutting edge of a growing field of thought concerning Black rebellion. This cadre of scholars includes the likes of the late Ella Forbes, the Volia Glimpf, Aisha Finch, Vanessa Holden, and Catherine Benjamin Golden, to name a few. The interventions being made represent, for me, arresting a way of violent Black rebellion from the gendered historiographies of Marxist historians, who use words like successful and unsuccessful to assess violent Black rebellion, depending on whether or not the state was captured, and towards thinking about and through the different possibilities violent Black rebellion creates, and indeed, what it also forecloses. Though unique in their approaches and questions, Force and Freedom and Fire and Water, by privileging the voices and actions of Black abolitionists between the 1830s and 1850s, and Black insurrectionists from the 1780s to the 1880s, respectively, together insist that we can reconsider the relationship between violent Black rebellion and abolition, that violence is a prerequisite for liberation. And this was as true then, just as it bears implications for our current specific historical moment now. Fire in the Water came to me before Force and Freedom. I arrived at both projects on the heels of finishing my dissertation proposal and had already grown tired of struggling and of waiting and of wrestling with performance studies in my attempts to tighten my conceptualization of violence. I'm forever appreciative of Drs. Warren and Carter-Jackson because their projects provided me with the grammars for which I was seeking. They wrote these books that said, violence is a storytelling device. Violence possesses narrative and semantic qualities. And with each instance of violent rebellion, a new story might be authored. I found their conceptualizations to be incredibly generative as their work uniquely informs my own dissertation project, which even as it builds from their interventions is located interdisciplinarily somewhere between the two. My project, thanks to Sylvia Winter's work on epistemology and violent Black rebellion, which is conceived as both theory and practice through the narrative and semantic form of a question mark. That is, violence itself is a question, an opening, a redirecting, a detour, and a refutation of sorts. This framing is in part because of the works of Dr. Carter-Jackson and Dr. Warren. And so when I say I'm very grateful and excited to talk to them about their work, I mean that sincerely. And here's why, I got more, and here's why. As I've already mentioned, I read Dr. Warren's Fire in the Water first, and so I'll begin here. One of the things I find incredibly generative about Dr. Warren's work is the way the project is framed through hybridity. She identifies a Black sailor as this hybrid and liminal figure that represents at once both the elements of free and unfree. Oh, sorry. And the cases that warrant studies are paired with works of fiction informed by real life examples. What emerges is a method of blurring that helps us understand the ways in which fictive elements become entangled with historical fact. Instead of writing a project that carries with it the burden of providing the veracity of certain seditious or insurrectionary actions, Warren works with both fact and fiction to elucidate the ways in which the possibilities of violent Black insurrection were often buried by mainstream abolitionists in favor of what was deemed politically expedient. In one place, Dr. Warren, within your conversation about Douglass's heroic slave and Delaney's Blake, you write that even in the realm of fiction, even that which they could imagine regarding the potentiality and possibilities of slave insurrections became ensnared and in service to the politics of white abolitionists. And that exact quote is on page 77. But even the plane of fiction that continues to haunt me still as it instructs and cautions. The imaging of the supplicant slave as perpetual victim in the abolitionist narrative and the method they deployed of documenting and witnessing the always enacted upon slave that never acts was both more palatable and always at odds, save for a couple of small moments, with Black insurrection. And this is particularly placed in the context of our current historical moment. And here I'm thinking of the Hands Up, Don't Shoot movement that we saw a couple of years ago. And of course, the ongoing gratuitous and voyeuristic-like imaging of Black people being abused, neglected, wounded, and are killed. I hope to talk with you more about this in your conversation about, quote, the natural right to revolt, end quote, as it relates to your reading of the Amistad case later in the time that we have together. But what I found most moving about your project, Dr. Warren, is that the use of violence by Black people to challenge their unfreedoms is deeply life-affirming and deeply human. And so I thank you for your work, and I thank you for being here. All right, Dr. Carter Jackson, you ready? All right. I read Dr. Carter Jackson's book after Dr. Warren's, and I find it interesting. Think about the ways in which the grammars of the American Revolution dulled the deviousness of violent Black rebellion in the hands of white abolitionists, as was the case with Dr. Warren's work. But as we see with the Black abolitionists in Force and Freedom, the rhetoric of the American Revolution, along with their faith and the Haitian Revolution, provided the bulk of their ammunition for insisting upon violent revolt. This is an interesting distinction for me because there is something to suggest that there is something about Blackness that capacitates the transmutation of those stories to make something new of the old and borrowed terms. It is through the voices of the Black abolitionists that Dr. Carter Jackson privileges that we come to learn why the leaders of the Black abolitionist movement view nonviolence as irrational in the struggle against slavery, and how it is that they understood violence constituted the means by which freedom was envisioned through emancipation, excuse me. But Dr. Carter Jackson, I'm not gonna lie. The first time I read your book, I couldn't really get past the framing of liberation for the enslaved as it was tethered to the grammars of liberal democracy. I was, and in many ways still, hold on to what Sadia Hartman writes in Scenes of Subjection about the impossibility of the state to be a vehicle for redress for the enslaved. And that if nonviolence was irrational, then so too was appealing to the same system that created the very conditions of their status and property. The second time I read Force and Freedom, I began to think about all of the attempts that the enslaved and the progeny made in appealing to the state for redress, and began to consider the depths of such hopes and cries and lamentations. And reading it for the third time to prepare for our conversation here today, I must admit, there's actually something heroic here. Like, there might be actually something heroic here, as Carter Jackson suggests. And this is not because there is anything romantic about suffering, But because anyone who believes in something so deeply and so sincerely that they are ready to die for those beliefs, as many were ready, as many are ready, and as many did and do die for the ideas gesture towards those contained within the grammars of equality, equity, freedom, and liberty. That's reason enough for me to think seriously about what's at stake in their efforts towards liberation, however defined. The story that Dr. Carter Jackson narrates in Force and Freedom is incredibly rich in archival resources. It is honestly and truly a remarkable feat to hold the voices that you do in the way that you do, with care, respect, and to narrate these stories within the amalgamate of the story you have written is truly incredible. But what I find most interesting and exciting about your work, Dr. Carter Jackson, is that when you say Black violent rebellion, quote, is inflicted its own form of terror, end quote. I find this generative because not only is it external to a lexicon of legitimacy, but it also suggests violent Black revolt possesses a pedagogical valence that instructs even in its absence. I'm excited to talk with you, Dr. Carter Jackson, because I have questions. So thank you for being here, and I appreciate it. So then I will ask that either of you, it doesn't matter which one begins, provide us with like an arc of the narrative of your book project.
I think Dr. Carter Jackson is indicating I should go first. I don't know that I have words because it is, I have never so thoroughly heard my work quoted back to me in a way that I meant it to be received. And after this talk, I'm gonna have to go away and sit with that for a while because I am a bit overwhelmed at the generosity of your reading of my book. I came at this project from a few different points, and I won't talk for too long, but I wanted to consider revolutionary history from the standpoint of enslaved people. And as a literary scholar, I am interested in how fictionalization or novelization critique and or thematize the problem of historical narrative. And my point of entry for this was the work of Herman Melville, because his method of layering history was both interesting and instructive. At the beginning of his final work, the posthumously published Billy Budd Sailor, he uses the sighting of a Black handsome sailor as a point for his departure of the story of the doomed white sailor Budd. And this was sort of the way I open the final chapter of my book. So I'm going to briefly just show you that quote so you can see what I'm talking about now. And he says, in Liverpool, oops, excuse me. Half a century ago, I saw under the shadow of a great dingy street wall of Prince's Dock, an obstruction long since removed, a common sailor so intensely Black that he must needs have been a native African of the unadulterated blood of Ham, a symmetric figure much above the average height, the two ends of a gay silk handkerchief throw loose about his neck, danced upon the displayed ebony of his chest. In his ears were big hoops of gold and a Highland bonnet with a tartan band set off his shapely head. It was a hot noon of July, and his face, lustrous with perspiration, beamed with barbaric good humor. In jovial sallies right and left, his white teeth flashing into view, he rollicked along the center of a company of his shipmates. These were made up of such an assortment of tribes and complexions as would have well fitted to be marched by Anacharsis Clootz before the bar of the first French assembly as representatives of the human race. At each spontaneous tribute rendered by the wayfarers, this Black pagode, the fellow, the tribute of a pause and stare, and less frequently an explanation, the motley retinue showed that they took a sort of pride in the evoker of it. And I will stop sharing there. So I was really interested in this because this selection layers both the revolutionary history of France, The sighting of the timing of the sighting sort of the sailor is roughly around the time of the Amistad mutiny, and the reference to Anacharsis Clutes also kind of brings the histories of Haitian and French revolutionary history together. So this is really instructive to me, was about the way in which literature doesn't just point to one historical moment, but several points in abolitionist and revolutionary history simultaneously. And it was this simultaneity that helped me develop my own methodology. So part of that development was also a result of my second question. And it's been a question I've had most of my life, but Melville helped me to formulate it into something more concrete. And that question was about the constraints around Black violence and the way in which revolutionary narrative is part of this exclusionary process and how it manifests itself in the pathologization of Black people. So I became interested in shipboard insurrection for two reasons. The first is the ship as both a real and imagined space in which revolutionary fantasies can both be projected and realized. And the way in which shipboard insurrection remains an underappreciated site of Black resistance. So what I was able to do once I started forming my research around these issues is to build an argument that framed Black resistance to enslavement as proactive rather than reactive. And this is important because the framing of Black resistance has always been about it as a response to long-term brutality. Reading Michel Rocriot was incredibly important because it gave me a theoretical framework around critiquing Black violence as unthinkable. And if you look at the history of amelioration efforts in the early modern period and the 18th century, they're all built around the belief that if you make slavery less brutal, insurrections will be infrequent. But the moment that you show that violence is the reflexive reaction to being deprived of freedom, you see that the only so-called condition necessary to produce insurrection is that of unfreedom. And that was important to me because it established how the right to revolt is one that has been racialized, and racialized not simply through the history of enslavement, but also the history of abolition. So my Black sailor framing was something that took a while to emerge. And initially I wasn't going to discuss Denmark Vesey's conspiracy at all because it wasn't a shipboard insurrection. But when I started reading the legal documents and about his suspected links to Haiti, something clicked. And now I have these real people and their fictional avatars, or in the case of Alada Iguiano, the novelized avatars, as a way of linking history to literature in a concrete way. And this interplay between real and fictional characters allowed not just for making parallelisms, but also showing how these real people were characterized in historical documents. And so the final consideration was to consider how history and focusing on these in-between moments get away from the gravitational pull of the Haitian Revolution, the passing of the Fugitive Slave Act, and the Civil War. And this was important because it allowed me to look at how the moments of the Amistad and Creole mutinies were small but pivotal, particularly as they played a part in Frederick Douglass's evolution as a radical abolitionist and in thinking about the abolition movement as being factionalized. It also shows how those watershed moments can be deceptive in the way that they frame history after the fact. So of course they are important, but they're not the only moments that help shape political change. So there's obviously more to it, but that was sort of how the project unfolded and why it looks the way that it does today.
Thank you.
So hello everyone. First, I just want to say thank you for that kind introduction. Michael, you have read my book 3 times more than my family members have. So that's, I was like, once, twice, 3 times. That's huge. That's huge. Thank you so much, Professor Rayford and the Department of Africana Studies. This is just, it's always really flattering to have people read your work and to want to discuss your work. We spend a lot of time writing these books. You know, this work is both personal and political. And so to be able to talk about it is just always really special. I came to my project through Benjamin Quarles. Benjamin Quarles is probably one of my favorite historians. He's written everything, at least to me, everything that at the time was just really central to my understanding of the 19th century and Black abolitionism. And he had a book that came out in, I think it's 1968 or 69, called Black Abolitionist. Very simple title. But I thought that coming back to Black abolitionists was essential because the historiography is changing. I will be fair, it's changing, but in the past, you know, 20 years still is very white male centric. And I didn't want my undergraduate students to think that the abolitionist movement was this white man's burden, this white man's push to like eradicate slavery that really did not make Black men and women as central figures in their own emancipation. And so it was important for me to center Black abolitionists for a lot of reasons. One, because I see them as the first abolitionists, right? No one needed to tell them that slavery was wrong or bad. They knew that from the moment, you know, slavery comes on the scene. But two, also because they're the most susceptible to the brunt of pro-slavery violence. They had their churches destroyed and their schools destroyed, and they were constant targets of violence. And I wanted to talk about that. And I also wanted to talk about what I think is a pretty rationale, which is that slavery starts in violence. Slavery is sustained by violence. And so Black abolitionists were like, it only makes sense that slavery will be overthrown by violence. And so one of the lines I say in the book is that, you know, William Lloyd Garrison is pushing nonviolence and moral suasion. And I'm probably botching my own quote, but it's this idea that like, if moral suasion is the house that William Lloyd Garrison built, Black people are merely renters, right? They don't own this idea. They're like, sure, we'll come, we'll stay. But like, the utility of nonviolence loses a lot of its utility and its power, certainly when 1815 comes with the Fugitive Slave Law. And now all Black people, free or enslaved, are susceptible to being kidnapped, to being captured, to being sent to the South. And so Black people realize that they have to organize, they have to protect themselves. And they make these like quasi-military groups. They have these vigilant societies, these Black self-protection societies that you see like in Christiana, Pennsylvania. And I got so empowered reading these stories because it was awesome to read about Black people that were standing up and defending themselves and resisting. And I knew that Black people resisted, but no one talked about explicitly how much Black people were like, yeah, I got a gun and I shot him, right? Like, you know, like the kind of like matter of fact moment, like I told him, stop coming for me. He didn't. I slayed him. Like, and that,
straight up. Yes, straight up. Boom, boom, yes, boom, boom, boom.
It was so. Yeah. It was just so empowering. And so I was like, I've got to give these men and women voices. I've got to put them at the center, take them from the margins and put them at the center. And I've got to destigmatize violence because I think Americans have not been honest about violence. Americans love violence. They have this very romantic, seductive relationship with violence. You know, there is a reason the Second Amendment is the Second Amendment, you know what I mean? Like the need for guns and protection is very much tethered to white supremacy. And I wanted to push back on that because there's always a push to make Black people nonviolent, to encourage them towards nonviolence. And I was like, why? Because the oppressor is not nonviolent. And so some of the key questions I asked was, you know, how should the oppressed respond to their oppression? How should the oppressed respond to their oppression? What is the role of the federal government? What is the role of the state? What is the state's responsibility in responding to dissent? Like, how should the federal government respond to dissent? And then lastly, and this is maybe a combination of all those questions, is how do the powerless procure power? What do you do when you are not a citizen, when you are considered a person who has no rights a white man is bound to respect? What do you do when you don't have the traditional channels of the ballot to be able to, you know, elect officials that will serve your interests or advocate for your interests? How do you make violence communicate your personal and political desires? And, you know, violence for me is very much a language. It speaks, it's conversant, and Black people are fluent in violence just as much as white people are. And I wanted to be able to have these hard conversations. So I'm grateful to my advisor, Eric Foner, who was like, yeah, violence is hot, Kellie. You gotta talk about it. And I was like, you know, and now more than ever, I could not have predicted, or maybe I should have predicted, given that we're historians and we study the past, but I could not have predicted that when the book came out in 2019, that it would be such an explanation for a lot of the unrest and rebellion that we saw in 2020 and that we still see. And not just in the United States, but all over the world. And it goes back to that question of like, how do the oppressed respond to their oppression? How do the powerless procure power? What is the role of the government, you know, and the nation in responding to political dissent? And I think Black people have answers. I think they've always had answers about how they procure their power and how they respond to their oppression. And so that's what I hope the book does, is addresses those questions.
Thank you. Actually, I think both of the projects here are working to destigmatize violence. But now, this is kind of not sequitur, but because Dr. Carter Jackson, you introduced it here, this is my second set of questions I really wanted to ask. And so I'm going to get into it. And I want to come back to the temporality of violence, because in each case, both in Fire in the Water and Force and Freedom, there's a different temporality of violence that I want to discuss. But again, second list that I really wanted to ask, I wanted to see if you opened up the door, and you did. So you really, really have been out here doing the good Lord's work, talking to these white folks about Black violence. Like, I went to your webpage, and yo, there was one presentation whereby on a PowerPoint, you have Jesus Christ hated racism. What is happening? So like, I'm said
racism is a sin. Yeah.
So like, I'm actually interested, like, what have you learned in doing that very, very public facing work and communicating the dense concepts in, you know, academic work to a general public?
It's hard because my work requires a lot of nuance. I think if you were to just take a pull quote from an op-ed or an article or a book, you might think that I was condoning violence. And I think that the backlash, I think that a lot of people have, or this visceral response that people have about violence and force, I think, I was not prepared for how much people would respond to it. But I will say that most of my response has been positive. Most people want to understand and want to get to sort of the heart of this matter, especially like in our context right now. You know, people are eager, people are curious, and they want to know why people are mad or why people loot, or why people say burn it all down, or why people are angry, you know, they want to understand that more. And so, I mean, it's not, and I'm sure you can talk to this, speak to this as well, Professor Warren, like it's not easy talking about violence. It's not easy studying violence, because oftentimes when you're talking about violence, while it's empowering to talk about a Black person fighting back, you're also simultaneously studying stories of violence that's been enacted on Black bodies, that's, you know, that's brutalized Black people. And it's exhausting work. I was joking to a friend, I was like, my next book will be on the history of unicorns and lollipops. Like, you know, like, because it's just, it is a lot, it's a lot to focus on Black people and violence and make a case for the legitimacy of that violence, which I think is really, you know, in the 19th century, it's easy to do that because we can say, of course, slavery was wrong. Of course, they ran away. Of course, they fought back or shot back. Slavery is bad. Even in the 20th century, you can kind of say, yeah, Jim Crow was bad. Segregation was bad. You know, like Bull Connor, that's bad, right? But in the 21st century, I think we have a harder time calling white supremacy as awful as it is. Mm. I mean, even the fact that we struggle to call January 6th an insurrection, right? Or we struggle to say like, no, it's just a skirmish. Like, we have a really hard time calling a spade when it comes to white supremacy and violence. And we have a hard time when we see Black people using nonviolence. We have a hard time with Colin Kaepernick taking a knee. We have a hard time with boycotts and you know, protests. So how do you talk about like burn it all down when people lose their minds over kneeling at a football game? Do you know what I mean? Like, you can't make that leap. And so it's easy for me to be in the 19th century because I get a little bit more support when we're talking about slavery than when I'm talking about anything else.
You joke about your next project being on unicorns, but the book I'm working on has joy in the title right now.
I noticed that. And there seems to be something very real about the work of thinking through violence, even as it is, again, being enacted upon them instead of us. Because, you know, you got a podcast called Oprahdemics, Dr. Warren. I did see the title of Joy in your book. So I guess if we can, like, this is kind of three problems, I'm going to throw it out there. Dr. Warren, I think your work, if you can, actually speaks to some of this backlash and the ways in which the mainstream abolitionist movements constrained the possibility of violent Black insurrection, both then and gestures towards how that has that legacy has been inherited today in our moment. So I'm wondering if you talk about that, and then to go back to this temporality of violence. Dr. Warren, you said earlier about how the moments, the very moments of unfreedom creates the possibilities for a violent revolt. And Dr. Carter Jackson, you talk about violence as an ideology of last resort, when moral suasion doesn't work, when the battle doesn't work. So I'm wondering if you could both talk about that and what's at stake with the differing temporalities.
I think part of what I wanted to show is that the kind of give me liberty or give me death rhetoric was not available even in a moment where enslaved people were being brutalized. And the question I have is, why does it have to be? So I think, if you're a scholar of the Enlightenment, one of the things that John Locke says, and we can talk, is that, that deprivation of freedom is a moment to retaliate. You know, deprivation of freedom is an act of war. So I've been really interested as the whole period of enslavement as a period of protracted warfare, rather than this period of oppression with flare-ups, and then the Haitian Revolution, and then the Civil War. And so thinking about unfreedom as the only condition required for violence lowers the stakes on Black people having to prove their freedom or prove their worth, prove their humanity. I was very interested in the humanity of violence, the reflexive of violence. I was very reflexivity of violence. I was very interested in the fact that stand your ground is seen as very reflexively natural, but not for everybody. And so if you want to bring it to the current moment, this idea that that Black people, all they need to say is, I was being kidnapped and I was afraid, so I fought back, versus I had been assaulted, whipped, humiliated for decades and centuries, needed to be not part of the question. And part of what I was confronting a lot in classrooms was sort of accounts of enslavement that didn't seem that bad. And this is part of the reason I'm writing a book on Phyllis Wheatley right now. Part of the problem with that framework is you need to think, in my philosophy, you need to think of the crime of slavery as happening at the moment that you decide to own another person. The crime of slavery isn't the moment you hurt somebody. It isn't the moment you sell somebody. It's the moment that you decide that ownership of another human being is wrong. So in lowering the stakes for having to show that slavery is wrong, you you confront your interlocutors with their value system and what actually they mean when they say freedom. Because if you mean freedom, that's really the only thing that needs to needs to be taken away for the potential for violence to happen. So I hope that that goes some way to answering your question.
Thank you. Kara Jackson, you up?
Yes. Reframe the question for me again.
All right, got you. So we were talking about this backlash to the effects of talking about violent rebellion now in this moment. And I was trying to get back to the idea that in both projects, there is a differing temporality of violence, wherein in Dr. Warren's, as she just explained, violence is at the first instance of unfreedom. And in yours, it's the politics, the ideology of last resort.
Last resort, yeah. I think part of that, for the Black abolitionists that I write about, is that two things are happening. One, they're trying to use their activism to affirm their humanity, right? So by using the Bible, by using moral suasion, by using nonviolence, it's one way to say, see, I'm a human being just like you. I can be rational. I don't want revenge, right? Like, it's a way of sort of assuaging white people's ideas about Black humanity. But when that doesn't work, and when that won't be heeded or heard, then violence becomes another way of proving their humanity too, right? Of saying like, okay, so you don't want to believe that I'm a person. So when I use violence, do you believe that I'm a man now? Do you believe that I'm a woman now? When you have to contend with this, how are you going to reckon with that? And I think that, you know, the 19th century is so interesting because there's so much, and I kind of wish I did this more in the book. There's elements of religion with it. You can't really talk about the 19th century and not talk about like biblical references or not talk about, you know, the Second Great Awakening or the idea that people believe that Christ is coming back. They believe that slavery is a sin, and they have tethered sin to these spiritual ideas in which people can be convicted of their wrongdoing, right? But, you know, it's interesting to me to see how, and this is not with just the abolitionists, this is a through line, I think, in Black history. This is something that Toni Morrison talks about as well. It's sort of like the willingness to patiently wait for people to have their aha moment, or to have this kind of like, oh, okay, my bad, I get it, you're free. That is so interesting to me in Black history. I think Toni Morrison talks about this. She has this great quote where she's talking about the LA riots. We're about to have the 30th anniversary of the LA rebellions, I should say, for the Rodney King verdict. And she says, you know, Black people should have rebelled when they saw the video. They should have rebelled when they saw the footage of Rodney King being beaten, but they didn't. They waited. They waited for justice. They waited for the courts. They waited for a conviction, and they didn't get it. And so then they rebelled. And that was the response. And I think all throughout history, we see moments in which Black people are like, you know what, violence is gonna be a last resort, because there's a clear understanding that they are outnumbered or outgunned. And so there are attempts to sort of persuade people. But what my book really talks about is that persuasion cannot convince people whose sole allegiance is to white supremacy and to the institution of slavery and to anti-Blackness. There's no persuading that is possible, not in a moral sense anyways, for the abolitionists to make use of.
So again, you opened the door. This is not on list two, but there's actually something I wanted to ask you. Particularly so, the example Early on in your book, Dr. Kyra Jackson, Maria Stewart, Black school teacher in Boston, and she, you say that she's engaged in holy warfare. And later on in the book, you know, Sadia Hartman might call it the enduring logics of slavery. You call it the enduring spirit. The spirit of slavery still remains. And so I guess, you know, if you, when you said you wish you could have done more with like that concept, of what would that look like?
I mean, so that's my next
because
question.
I caught it, you know, I caught it. When you said holy warfare, I was like, all right, bet.
It is. I mean, it is absolutely. There's another, there's a woman, I'm forgetting her name. She's the first Black woman graduate at Oberlin College. But she says, slavery is the ultimate crime. It is warfare. It is warfare. There's another quote in the book by Abby Kelly where she says, like, let's not pretend we're that slavery is not war. It is war. And it has been waged unremittingly against the slave ever since the slave has been in bondage. So this idea of thinking of slavery, as Professor Warren said is too, it's like the moment you're enslaved, you're at war, right? You have to defend that. I think it's a through line that you see as well too. And it is, as much as I said, I'm getting away from violence. I'm gonna talk about lollipops. Like I wrote an op-ed about violence, and then a bunch of publishers were like, is this a book? And I was like, yeah, no, maybe. Like, and so it has become a book, which is my next project, which is called The Remedy, which is, The Remedy, Black Response to White Violence. And it looks at history as a way of explaining how Black people have responded to their oppression. And it goes like from the colonial era to the 19th century to the 20th and to our present moment. But it looks at revolutionary violence and gun violence and protective violence and what I'm coining joyful violence, how Black people use joy as a weapon against white supremacy. But I think that all of these things have connected to them really hard ideas of violence, of humanity, of spirituality, of all of these like ideological concepts that come to blows when we start talking about Black liberation and Black freedom and what justice should look like. It's what I'm still grappling with, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. How much time do we have left, Rafer, before the Q&A?
About maybe 1:15 or so we could go to.
All right. So then, I'm sorry, what?
I was going to say, and to all our folks out there, you can put questions in the Q&A function.
So I'm going to move to the third list right now. Dr. Warren, I'll start with you. So one of the things I'm thinking through in my dissertation is piracy. And I'm thinking, beginning with Cicero's concept of the pirate as the enemy of all, and how those logics have been transformed and carried and endured, like in terms of Black people being always on the outside of the responsibility of the state to care. And in your talk about the Amistad, you know, I got questions because I think it might have been my second semester here, Dr. Cohen was like, yo, there were Black pirates. And I was like, oh my goodness, are you serious? Like, that is so gangster. That is so gangster. Like, how? And like, they were slaves. And then they insurrected. They took over the very means by which was intended to break them, to make them slaves in the transportation. So I was like, yo. So of course I got all the rhetoric books. I went down all the rabbit holes. And so, yeah. And so I guess in the Amistad, I'm particularly interested because it was through violence. Like, so first they're categorized as cargo, right? They say, but it was through violence that then shifted their status from cargo to property to human, but it was through the appellation of pirates that allowed, and you know, violent insurrection that allowed them to move from cargo to person, but still on the outside of that framing of, I guess, citizen with rights or what have you. And so I guess I'm interested in, what do you make of that? Like, violence made this change.
So let's apologize to everybody watching because we're about to geek out a little bit. this was a rabbit hole I spent a long time trying to go down, and I just couldn't find the there because some mentor asked me, like, what do you want to find in the archive that you're not finding? Like, I want to find Black pirates that were freeing slaves in the 19th century. That's what I want to find. And I couldn't find it. And so I think what I did find, though, was really, really vexed this stuff about smuggling in between 1808 and around 1820. And then, slave smuggling becomes categorized as piracy. And I spent a lot of time on Du Bois's dissertation, who was basically documenting all instances of sort of illegal slave trade. And this makes sort of like Amistad and Creole cases so interesting, because piracy is such a weird history, because it starts off in the 18th century, first as like legalized terrorism, the buccaneers of England, and then they all get, kicked to the curb by the crown, and then they become pirates, and they disrupt the slave trade. They use slave ships as their own ships. They threaten the slave power, at its heart, its economic heart, and then that's why it has to be suppressed. And then piracy becomes something. And then you have Algerian pirates. I'm sorry, everybody, we're getting really deep into the weeds here. So I think part of the problem is the question depends on finding evidence that I could not find in terms of, if there are Black 19th century Black pirates in this period, they are not available in the current archive that I was able to find. I might be wrong, I did not find it. But one of the interesting things about the Amistad and the Creole case is in that slippage between cargo, human, and piracy, they find at the end of the line there, the definition of, of the right to revolt, the natural right to revolt. I don't have an answer to that. I would be fascinating to keep going on about this for an hour or two more, because I think this question of piracy is really interesting because we have this romantic vision of pirates that still exists today. We have like Pirates of the Caribbean, Our Flags Are Death, Black Sails, and there's a way in which the Black figure is present, but also both kind of evanescent within these pirate narratives. So finishing your dissertation, trying to nail down the pirate part will take you a while, but I think it is worth playing with, because I did spend that whole Denmark essay chapter was initially about piracy, and it just fell apart on me.
Really?
It was also about James Fenimore Cooper and slave smuggling in Florida, and I better stop so we don't
get... No, dude, we got time. We got time.
If you want to, I don't know if you have done the research into the Pirate Cove in Florida. And if you done there and looking at New Orleans as a pirate sanctuary. The heartbreaking things I did find were that you had a lot of Black pirates smuggling slaves. And I think that's the thing you're going to have to, if that's a place that you want to be willing to go if you want to go there. And it's part of it. It was interesting about pirates is they're not the kind of proto-communists that Redeker kind of says they are. They are hardcore capitalists. And in the 19th century, to be a hardcore capitalist is to traffic in Black bodies. So I think that's where you have to kind of figure out, you know, how, like how much, where you want to go there.
Yeah, because that's not gangster.
Well, it's a different kind of gangster.
yeah, you're right. So I guess like as a last follow-up to this selfish question with you, Dr. Warren, you make the distinction between land and sea. Mm-hmm. And I think, again, I'm pretty sure it was in your conversation with Douglas and Blake, you explained that even on the water, like the ocean, this vast space of limitless possibilities. I mean, I think Foucault calls it like but yet even our imagination to conceive of insurrection on the sea was erased. Mm-hmm. And you had attributed that in part to the way in which the pirate figure becomes ensconced within, well, becomes mainstream and then loses its deviousness as it's conscripted into the American Revolution rhetoric. I don't have a question about that, I guess. It was just, I was saddened by that because I felt that.
Well, I mean, I think part of it is also understanding what the market for Black writing is in the 19th century. You know, Douglas is writing an Autographs for Freedom. It's a propaganda piece, and he's speaking to get people free. And the thing about that story, The Heroic Slave, is the pivotal moment isn't the insurrection. It's when Listwell decides to slip the files in Madison Washington's hands and gives him the tools to commit insurrection. And it's in some ways where the kind of radicalism of the book is, if it's hidden anywhere else, if it's erased everywhere else. It's in the moment where this white man says, I am going to give the tools to fight back, and I am going to commit myself to bloodshedding too. So Douglas is really interested not just in heroicizing Black violence, but in creating collaborative efforts. He's interested in solidarity too. So I think sort of from the standpoint of sort of looking for a confrontational moment in the book, you're not going to find that. But there's other there's little kernels that you can hold on to.
Thank you, Dr. Warren. I appreciate that. All right, Dr. Kara Jackson.
Ooh.
So I want to talk about the Christina Rebellion.
Yeah.
So that's the chapter I'm currently working on. I'm just going to throw things out at you, and I hope, you know, you can, okay. I love the concept of protective violence. You see that at every instance with their organizing work with against slave patrollers and slave catchers. When William Parker says, yo, the women finished him talking about his wife and his wife's sister, gangster. You know, and there's something like very devious about that, because in all of the archives, in all of the court transcripts, it's unfathomable as the violence of killing Edward Gorsuch is attributed to the men. Yeah. Like that, the fact that it's unfathomable, unthinkable. But I want to talk to you about this. So early on in the book, Dr. Kara Jackson, you say that violent Black rebellion was a means of perfecting democracy. You want me to read it to you, or you got it? You look unsure. I'm not lying.
Sure, go ahead. Sure.
In short, Black resistance to slavery offered Americans an opportunity to perfect democracy. And so in Christiana, I think through the documents that some of the Quaker historians have produced, William Parker, Eliza, and their comrades understood very clearly and in their own words that they don't have a country, but we have no country. I'm thinking about the work of Frances M. Beale. I'm thinking about even Avery Gordon, and thinking about the way in which there is something to be said about creating the conditions of living without appealing to the state, but creating the very conditions for the life that you want, as if those conditions were already made possible. And so there's like an ignoring of the state. And I see that very much in Christiana. You know, when Eliza was ringing the bell and everyone come, you know, like in one text, it was like, yo, 50 to 100 niggas showed up with guns and swords and corn cutters, like ready, you know?
Let's go.
For real, boom, 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 boom.
Love it.
But we had no country. And so therefore they're not trying to perfect democracy. And so like, I guess my question to you is like, how do you think about that? Both in the context of what we've already discussed in terms of the enemy and you know, the resulting treason case, whereby they too were tried in absentia, but particularly about the fact that their protective violence was not in service to protect or in perfecting democracy.
Yes and no, right? I say yes and no because Parker's absolutely right when he says, and I hope I don't botch the quote, but he says basically like, hey, we don't want to start a fight, but if the white people come to us, we will defend ourselves. But there are
not
no,
if you buck.
He says, there are no policing forces that will support us. We don't have a country. This is pre like Dred Scott and all that stuff. We don't have a country. And I think that he's absolutely right in saying that. He's not wrong. I also think, though, that when I think about democracy, I'm not thinking about little d democracy, like how we think of it in terms of like blue states and red states or like the political infrastructure of that. When I say democracy, I mean the actual principles of living out a political system in which all men are created equal. Now that's not how it plays out. We know that's not what it is on the ground, but the idea of living in a country that says all men are created all equal, all men have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those aren't bad things. Those aren't bad ideas. Now they don't include everyone, but at a surface level, or even at a deeper level, thinking about how do we implement a world, a country, a society in which Black people have access to that, and to force white people to face the hypocrisy that they themselves have perpetuated by creating this rhetoric, more than rhetoric, this Constitution, this Declaration of Independence, these ideas, and yet not lived up to at all. I mean, it's so encapsulated in Frederick Douglass's What to the Slave is the 4th of July. He's like, this is all BS. Do better, like be what you say you are, right? And I think that like Black people throughout history have always been denied citizenship, always. And yet they still are adamant about pursuing that citizenship, claiming that belonging, claiming their humanity, claiming their rights, their inalienable rights. And so while they don't have citizenship, they, I think, use force and violence as a way of reminding the general public that they should be, right? And that they themselves are more entitled to it, you might say, than anybody else, than certainly anybody that's coming for them. There's a lot about that particular moment. I have another article that's called Dare You Meet a Woman. It dives a little bit more into that and Eliza. And, you know, I think it's also interesting that Eliza doesn't just pull out a corn cutter for Edward Gorsuch. She pulls out a corn cutter for her brother-in-law, who's terrified, and just says, just give them up. And she was like, I will chop off your head before I give up any of these enslaved brethren, you know, because you're scared. Like, and I think that's also compelling to me too, that Black women were willing not just to like slice white heads, but any head that tried to get in front of their freedom and somebody else's freedom. Right. And that to me is like the epitome of protective violence. It's not just self-defense. It's not just I'm protecting my home and household. It's like all people, this collective understanding that violence can be used to protect the collective, to protect all people.
So the collective is all people, like not just small communities, but we're talking about like the world over.
I would say, let me be more specific, oppressed people. Oppressed people. I think that's more an adequate description because, you know, people that are oppressors don't need protecting in that way. It's oppressed people that need protecting. It's oppressed people that have to have some sort of way to secure themselves, their personhood, their bodies, their children, their kin, and even strangers who are seeking refuge.
I read, this is not, it's not non-sequitur, but I know we have to get to the Q&A, but I read a couple weeks ago that Eliza caught a body on the way up to Canada.
Yeah.
Like, again, she just out here. And John Brown
talks needs about a her whole
later.
Book.
Yeah, yeah. John Brown talks about her later. I think her mom is a full book. Yeah. Catherine Warner, Cassandra Warner, however that they name her, because she raised four kids to be runaway slaves and then enact protective violence, where Dr. Taylor says community feminism to protect. Feel free to keep going if you want. There are only two questions in Q&A.
Can I just say though, this is a pivot. I wanted to go back to what Professor Warren said about like piracy. So, and this may seem like a tangent, but like in Boston, there's a big children's museum, and then next to it, there's like a park, and there's a huge ship, a pirate ship, basically. And you know, it's got all the like little kids can be like, "Oi, matey," or whatever, you know, like they can play pirate. And at the bottom of the pirate ship, there are these crates. Crates that you would see on ships. And on the crates were marked sugar, tobacco, rum. And I was like, what? And in my mind, you know, you just see kids playing on the ship. And I'm like, these are slave commodities. These are slave commodities. Like, what are these kids doing playing pirates, right? And no one's paying attention to the fact that like, that there was like this historical element embedded into the playground. Now people complained and they scrubbed off the sugar label or whatever. But the idea that that people don't think about piracy as it relates to slavery, as it relates to the commodification of Black bodies, that it is just a playful Pirates of the Caribbean funny character with a hook or a patch. That fantastical memory has really co-opted like the horrors, the violence, and the commodification of the slave trade itself and of piracy. And maybe that's a tangent, but I just think it's interesting how like in the public memory, piracy is not taken seriously, not in that way.
And they took it very seriously in the 19th century, you know, oh God, I'm blanking on his name and I wrote about him, this is embarrassing, but you know, one of the major mutineers who went to sea with Melville's brother, like part of what they used against him is that he read all these pirate books. You know, they were the violent video games of the 19th century. And you know, they've been really Disneyfied right now. And I think this is why I was like, oh, Michael, you should write this, but I have warnings. There'll be dragons there, kind of thing. So, because I wanted to talk about sort of the relationship of 18th century piracy to 19th century's rhetorics of slavery and insurrection, et cetera, too. And I kind of wish they kept the rum and the sugar and everything there.
It's honest, right?
because piracy, you know, they were just as likely to sell enslaved people as to invite them to join the pirate ships. But pirate ships were made up of a lot of Africans. And so there's a kind of way in which looking at, you know, the pirate community as a heterotopia of the 18th century slave commodity or I'm saying that badly, but you know what I mean? It was so fascinating. And I'm sorry. It's an under researched part of the field, I think.
So I'm going to address some of these Q&As that we have. First, I want to thank you again for being here, for coming to talk with us. And, you know, just remember that I said I want to be lifelong thought partners. All right. Miss Muse, what's up, Miss Muse? Miss Muse asks, how do you offset the impact of your work on your soul? How do you recalibrate your mind and spirit to keep moving forward into the light of liberation?
So I was at the OAH, the Organization of American Historians. I was in Boston last month. I can't remember, or like a few weeks ago. Anyways, a good friend of mine was giving a paper and he was talking about how they had taken Black people from Africa and put them in like these circuses and sort of like freak shows, and how it was so traumatizing what happened to these young Black people that one young man took his life. Mm-hmm. And when he's telling the story, I've seen him give the story 3 or 4 times before. It's his book. He has another book coming out on it. And while he was speaking, he stopped and he choked up and he started to cry. And I was shocked. And he said, I don't know what's happening. I give this talk all the time. And I was like, I know what's happening. When you do this work, this really hard, violent, you know, soul-sucking work, there are moments when you get numb to it. And then there are moments when you get sobered up all over again and you realize, whoa, this is a real person. This is a child. This was someone's son. And so, my husband makes fun of me, but like, I go like extreme. Like I watch like smut TV, like trash TV.
like what?
I'm watching The Ultimatum right now. It's really good.
I have a dear friend who said the same thing, actually.
Like I love, you know, Love is Blind, The Bachelor, like don't judge me, but I need like something that will just completely like take me away from just the woes of white supremacy, because I become a person that's not fun to be around. Like I'm with my kids, I'm watching Disney, and then I'm deconstructing the Disney cartoon. Like, well, this is patriarchy and this, you know, like my kids don't want me to do that while they're watching, I don't know, some princess movie or whatever it is. So I have to find ways though to relinquish it for a bit and to pour in things that do fill me. I have 3 small children, so time with my kids does that a lot. Reading stories to them, traveling with them, playing in the backyard with them, reading books that you know give me another way of imagining what is possible in the future makes me feel really good. Being with my girlfriends and kikiing about whatever we want to talk about. Oprah-demics, actually podcasting has been a great way for me to find another avenue. Like I think there's something nostalgic about Oprah Winfrey that maybe I miss 4 p.m. on weekdays, where doing this podcast has given me a lot of life. There's still a lot of critique there, but at the same time, I am enjoying doing something that is not harmful to my spirit. And that brings me joy and makes me laugh. I think those things are really important. I worry about scholars that are so deep into their work that are like, I don't watch TV, I don't watch movies, I don't want, and it's like, that's okay, that's fine, but do you listen to music? Like, do you
weirdos, bro, yeah, weirdos. Calm
you out, have weirdos. Joy in your life, you know, like, I don't know, you have to have those things in order to be balanced.
What do you do, Dr. Warren?
Well, I was a lifelong hater of running, and I took up running as a way to keep my brain quiet.
That you're actually training for a marathon at some point.
I'm not right now. I can't.
Okay. You were at one point.
I've done a few. I've done 3 half marathons, and I would love to. My sister and my brother are the marathon runners of the family right now. I'm hoping to join them once I have a toddler, and it's hard to get away for 2 hours to do those, or 3 hours to do those really long runs. But I found exercise in trying to quiet my brain, and getting out of my getting into my body was really, really important. Mm. But there's also just, you know, my husband works with teaching college to incarcerated people. And there's a way in which restoring humanity to people who have, who people don't, you know, recognize it, finding ways to teach people to recognize the humanity of people who have done violent acts is incredibly important to me. And I think the, like, the work, the task of this has been worth it. The response to the work has been worth it. But it does mean, I remember when the movie Precious came out, all my friends were like, have you seen it? I'm like, I just read some of the most, I spent just weeks in the Huntington reading horrible things about happening on slave ships. I'm gonna go watch Totoro or all the Studio Ghibli stuff. I'm just gonna do that. Like I go, when I escape, I go into, like, you know, very, very fantasy anime and those places. And now that I have a son, with a mother who works in enslavement and a father who works in prison, there needs to be a place to come home and, you know, not do any of that. So, that's how I manage.
Thank you. This question comes from the homie, Catherine Benjamin Golden, Dr. Catherine Benjamin Golden, alumni here from the sixth floor in our department. She says, powerful people, much love to the six. Thank you for this crucial conversation about violence, reciprocity, and self-protection, which you've each noted ubiquitous across the period of our captivity. I wonder how you might, in your work and in our lives, also think about the role of violence beyond the ultimate practices, combat, fisticuffs, and war. Dr. Kellie Carter Jackson already began to address this by discussing ideological violence, but I'm thinking about the ways Black people have created cultures, communities, networks, or force or readiness to come to the everyday insight and use physical self-defense before they actually do so. Is there an experiential, strategic process of arriving to defensive violence and the ultimate decision to come to arms you have noted in your work that we can learn from?
I mean, yeah, this question is what I grapple with a lot. It's what I'm grappling with now in this book, about trying to think about what tools are effective, how to obtain things that work. And also, like, the reason why the last chapter is joyful violence is because Charles McKinney has this great quote where he says, like, we are not the history of fighting white people. Like, that's not who we are. Like, there's much more to our Black identity than just constantly wrestling with white people. And he's not wrong about that at all. And I wanted to just talk about the way that we make culture, the way that we make music and love and joy and create worlds that bring us a sense of freedom, even in the midst of slavery, right? Or even in the midst of oppression, is something that I'm constantly thinking about. I don't have a solution for it. I'm gonna be honest with you. Like, I don't have like a, here's my 3-point plan for freedom. Like, you know, and anybody who does is selling snake oil. Can I just say that? Anybody that's got a 3-point plan to end racism is lying to you.
Yeah, fuck out of here.
It's real. So I don't know. The short answer is I don't know, but I'm thinking about these things. I'm wrestling with these things all the time. And I'm thinking about how we develop real, meaningful, effective tactics that allow us to address this.
I think my current research is looking at the way people are living alongside oppression and trauma. Because I think, as that last question was really illustrative of, is that we're not just fighting all the time. We're running, we're mud-wrenching, we're making dinner, we're watching movies, we're raising children, we're living our lives. And one of the things I'm thinking about, the way idioms of resistance exist outside of violence, as a way of thinking about ways in which freedom can be located anywhere. This idea that even within oppression, there are pockets of freedom. They're temporal and temporary, but they exist. I'm kind of pushing back against the social death framing of the period of enslavement because it's too totalizing. There's no outside to it. And I'm really interested in work that shows the lived experiences of Black people alongside these more militant frameworks of resistance as well, as also constituting a resistance. And increasingly I'm coming to art making that explicitly resists capitalism as a way of kind of thinking, as a way of thinking through those processes. And I'm really in the, don't ask me to elaborate more deeply on that because I'm still working that out. But that's where I am right now.
I love that. I love that so much. Like that's so good. That's so good. I do think we put a overemphasis on the social death. That's not to say that it does not matter. But to think about, you know, we laugh all the time. You know what I mean? Like we laugh to keep from crying all the time, and not the shucking and jiving of the performative stuff for the master. I mean, like, we love, we laugh, we are real people, and studying that is so valuable.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was really fascinated by the fact that our books came out within months of each other because it's always interesting to feel that there's a kind of feeling about where research needs to go, and then it's not just you doing it.
Mm-hmm. This question of social death and more broadly Afro-pessimism was on my list of my second list of questions. We didn't get there. Dr. Rafer is telling me that it is time. So I want to thank everybody who came out. I want to thank you, Dr. Warren, you, Dr. Carr Jackson, for coming and hanging out. Truly thankful. And I don't know, I guess, is that it?
This was great.
I'm so happy I got to do this. This was a lot of fun. Please ask me back. I will come and talk more.
Yes, I will come back anytime. And I'm happy that we ended like on a high note and not like with death and doom and gloom. Like, it's always nice to sort of say, to sort of have like hope for the future, to keep doing the work.
Thank you.